Ronald Reagan was an extreme introvert. He was very uncomfortable around people. And after his death, they discovered mounds of cue cards. Everybody thought that he wandered into a room and brilliance poured out of his mouth. The truth is, next to everything he said was prepared. Cue cards, notes, information, quips. It's hard to know when to be silent and when to speak. And President Reagan became a master of communication, but not because his mind was filled with spontaneous wisdom, but because he studied non-stop. When men, particularly in the Congress and in the Senate, would approach President Reagan and make a comment about women, he would say the following. Wisdom tells us that we do not irritate a tired woman. And greater wisdom tells us we do not irritate an alert woman. They would be so confused that they were wandering away trying to figure out what he meant. You don't irritate a woman who's sleepy, and you don't irritate one who's rested. Some members of Congress and the Senate of the United States were still confused. I'm not surprised. If somebody would come to President Reagan and say, I love you, I think you're wonderful, everything that you say is perfect, I agree with all of your policies, he would say to them, be careful of those who fall at your feet. They may be reaching for the corner of the carpet under your shoes. And then he would smile. Do you remember the smile? Many of you do. Shake their hand warmly and walk away. Some say they never even felt it coming until it was deeply embedded in the gospel today. The disciples are gathered together. Jesus is revealing the great truth of the Christian church. He says to them, the Son of Man will live and die and rise again. This is the will of God. This message was the corner of the future of the Christian church, and they were so startled by it that they weren't sure how to process it. Has such a message of less messianic figures been stated? Have world leaders said these things to people around them and startled them beyond measure? President Lincoln was told by his secretary, Mrs. Kennedy, not to go to the theater that night. He went anyway. She said, you will be killed tonight. He ignored her, and he went to the theater. President Lincoln knew that at some point his life would be taken, but it was the wisdom of someone close to him that he missed. Years later, after President Lincoln's secretary, Mrs. Kennedy, told him not to go to the theater, years later, President Kennedy, whose secretary was Mrs. Lincoln, told him not to go to Dallas, Texas. You will be shot. First of all, maybe President Reagan had a point. Don't irritate a woman when she's tired, and don't irritate her when she's alert. More listening and less talking is worth considering. Jesus explained the great truth that Jesus must live and die and rise again, and that all humanity could be saved if they just believe. And people ignored him, and his disciples went into shock, and they were silent. You know, it's hard to know when to speak and when to be silent. And the disciples were confused and bewildered and overwhelmed, and so they were silent. Sometimes that happens to us. When somebody tells us something that's so overwhelming, there's a profound tendency to go quiet while we process. Sometimes we don't know what questions to ask. Sometimes we don't know how to handle the situation. There are times to speak and times to be silent. There are times to speak when we believe in something so strongly that we are forced from the deep forces of inside of us to speak out loud. When we want to comfort those around us who are wounded. When we want to affirm, encourage, and support each other. These are the times we must speak. But there are times where we must be silent. When we're really not sure what's going on around us. When we are confused. If we're not prepared to ask for guidance and advice, maybe it's time just to be silent. For most of us, the time to be silent is when we're angry. For this is when the forces of evil spew forth. Sometimes it's important to cool down before we say what's on our heart. The disciples responded to the great message of the gospel with shock. But only a little while later, they had the following conversation. If he's going to die, which one of us gets to take over? Which one of us will have the power? Which one of us will be able to redesign the message so that it's more palatable? Which one of us will be in charge? And they started to argue over who was the greatest, says Scripture. And Jesus caught them. I love his style. He walks over and he says, hey guys, what you talking about? You seem a little hot under the collar. Everything okay? And they're so embarrassed that again they're silent. Silence can be an indication that we're discomfort. With what's happening around us, that somehow we know that what we're thinking and talking about isn't very helpful. We need to be careful with when we choose to speak and when we choose to be silent and what motivates that. Joyce and I had been in this parish less than 2 weeks, and we were sitting in Swiss Chalet having dinner, having a conversation about the new congregation, talking about you all. And a member of the congregation who's here this morning reached across the bench, tapped me on the shoulder, and said, hello, Reverend Steve, I'm one of your members. She was within earshot of the whole thing. I got into the car and I said, oh, for heaven's sakes, what did I just say? So if you ever experience me to be silent, it's not that I'm a goody two-shoes. It's that I'm really confused. Or I'm angry. Or I'm hurt. Or I'm frustrated. And I know that to speak in those moments isn't healthy for anybody. Jesus was trying to teach his disciples when to speak, when someone's hurting, when someone's in need, when someone wants inspiration, when someone needs you to be there with them. These are moments to speak or to simply be present and hold them in the midst of the moment. The gospel goes a little deeper. And although we have very short time, I'm just going to try and touch on two other thoughts. One of the things we need to be reminded of is that sometimes we're so preoccupied with the stuff that's not important that we focus all of our attention on the things that aren't important. gossip, innuendo, conversation about people, places, and situations. I had an experience once where I was delivering a sermon, and apparently I looked at someone when I made the comment that when someone talks about everyone else, they're trying to ignore the extraordinary issues in their own home. That got me in a great deal of difficulty because I looked at somebody when I said that. I would like you to know at this exact moment, I can't see you. But the point remains that sometimes it's easier to point to others than to deal with the issues inside of us. And that day, Jesus, as he sat in the home of his disciples, he was trying to teach them how important it is to clean up your own house before you clean up the house of another, to address the issues that are urgent in your life before we try and sort out the issues of the other. Let me tell you that that's really hard, but it's really helpful.